The third part of the trio is Paul Morley, former rock journalist, who has made the unlikely transition to record company executive with surprising ease.
I kind of look at what I bring to show business and pop music in the root sense of those words, you know, almost a root sense of what surrealism means, which is being comical. I think there's a way to be a little bit comical within the structure of the record industry. Playful, I think that's all you can be, playful. And I think if you come through the record industry with a certain sense of detachment and irony, because of the surrounding, the environment is so pitifully unimaginative, then you only have to be slightly different and you appear to be wonderfully glamorous. When you wanna go. So-called intellectuals that criticise Relax for its content and saying that it was a fuss over nothing missed the point. We weren't actually claiming anything radical outside the chart context. We just wanted to play around with the idea of getting to number one, or what we thought getting into the top five with a cheeky record. Everybody else makes the fuss. I mean, we were quite cool and calm about it. We just thought it was funny. We had a few giggles.
And you know, Trevor will sometimes say, have you read what the music press has said about it? And I say, who reads the music press? If everybody who read the music press went out and bought a record, it still probably wouldn't be a hit. So who cares?
I know one rock critic who actually understands the mechanics of the industry and how difficult it is to retain any sense of intelligence and detachment. You know, you can criticise it because it is a shambles, and even if it, as a critic, even though you're not really involved in it, you're on the outside, you can see that it's a shambles. But when you're inside, you're immediately aware that you belong to something that isn't just commercially orientated. It's commercially orientated and very banal. I mean, it's not even making money in an intelligent manner, as we could say elsewhere, but it's possible. You know, it's run by people who have forgotten really why they're even making money out of it.
I realised that Paul was actually cared about music, and he understood certain things about music. And I thought it would be really interesting if someone like him had the power to actually decide how a record was marketed and what kind of video was done for it. I thought it might prove interesting. I thought all kinds of crazy things might happen. He might upset all sorts of people, and he has.
I invent the label in terms of, like, the Walt Disney fantasy of what a record label should be. Highly glamorous, slightly distant, you know, slightly mysterious. Trevor makes the records, which really is the thing. And Jill lubricates the business side of it. It's the perfect balance. We go from left to right.
The trouble is, when you get big record labels like CBS interested in somebody, they never originate anything. All they ever do is, you see, they buy things that that look pretty solid. Nobody was really interested in Frankie because their demo tape was a bit dodgy, and because they were going around wearing leather jock straps and showing very close up. You know, they had a video that was a close up of a groin, you know, pumping up and down.
Music to Paul is desperately important. Desperately important. And it really isn't desperately important to me. I mean, he truly feels it and, you know, believes in it. And
I have a great belief in the beauty of the pop single. Not that it's important or that it's good or bad. Just, you know, there it is. It's beautiful. I think maybe that's why the record industry is a little bit lost at the moment. It's forgotten what a beautiful thing a pop single can be. What a strange thing, you know, very odd, you know, all time could be in there if it's done well, all life. It's a very beautiful thing.
Welcome to Sam.